I'm very grateful to the organizers for the opportunity. If we need to participate in this conference, I will speak on the graphs with large chromatic number but locally small chromatic number. I'm sure I must start with defining what is this locally small chromatic number. So if we have a very large graph, usually we have access only to some part of it. And my question is, if we know some information about these such small parts, what can you say about some global properties of the graph? And usually, often this part is just a ball in the graph, ball in usual graph metric. So we say that a ball with center in some vertex and radius r is just a set of all vertices which are distant from this x most by r. The distance is the usual graph distance. And the first question, which would be quite naive, is to ask if we know that the chromatic numbers of all such balls with fixed radius r are bounded, can we bound the global chromatic number of the whole graph by some absolute constant? And surely, since this question is too general, the answer is also too general. The answer is that no such bound exists, and this is by well-known reasons. There is a famous theorem by Erdős, which shows that there exist graphs with arbitrarily large girth and arbitrarily large chromatic number. And if we ask for the chromatic number to be larger than n and for girth to be larger than g, then you can construct such a graph on n to almost to g vertices. So let's look a bit at the graphs which have these two properties. So at the graphs which have no small cycles and large chromatic number. So first of all, as I told, all the balls of some radius, namely the radius which is a bit smaller than half of the girth, are just trees. Otherwise they would appear a small cycle. So surely they are bipartite. On the other hand, from the same reason, we may bound a number of vertices in such graph from below. Since in minimal such graph, each ball should be a tree, and all the degrees of its vertices should be large. They should be at least n. So we get the lower bound for the number of vertices, even in a ball. And we may reformulate our question in order for it to have a sense. How small could be our graph if we know that its global chromatic number is large and all the balls are colorable in a small number of colors? So, intuitively speaking, we are not quite far from this theorem. At least for the case if we look at the chromatic number of the ball equaling to 2. Because we prohibit only even cycles, and it seems that mostly there are also odd cycles which have some influence on the chromatic number. And let us start exactly with this situation, so with the graphs which have no small odd cycles. And I will start with providing several examples of these graphs, which were So the first example which I would like to mention is Borsuk's graph, which was called so by Erdős and Haynau. And this is the following graph. We take n minus one dimensional sphere at the set of the vertices, and we connect two vertices with an edge if the distance between them is almost the diameter of the sphere. So it is 2 minus epsilon for some small epsilon. In this case, from Warsaw theorem, it follows that the chromatic number of this graph is n plus 1, at least if epsilon is small enough. And again, for small enough epsilon, we know that this graph contains no small odd cycles. Because if we have a sphere, and we are allowed to make the moves only of length at least 2 minus epsilon, then we may move to almost the opposite point. And surely this graph formally is infinite, but one may discretize this graph and obtain a finite graph displaying the same property. The second example, which is also well known, is Kneser graph. Well, we take a set of 2m plus d elements, and we suppose that d is small compared to m. The vertices of our graph are the subsets of this set of size m, and two vertices are connected with an edge when the corresponding subsets do not intersect. So again, we have no small cycles, no small odd cycles, as we see. And this was a conjecture by Kneser, which was solved by Loos, that the chromatic number of this graph is large enough, so it is, in fact, d plus 2, for d greater than 0. And in the same year, Schreiber improved a bit this example by taking an appropriate subgraph of this graph. Namely, he took only those vertices, those subsets of this set, which do not contain two consecutive numbers in a cyclical order. And he showed that the chromatic number of this graph is also d plus 2, and moreover, this graph is minimal. And the third example of a bit different sense is the generalized Michielski construction. And perhaps I should describe it because I will need similar constructions after. This construction goes as follows. We take some graph G, then we take several copies of the vertex set of graph G. Here are these four copies in our case. In the first copy, we draw graph G. And then, if two vertices are connected in G, then we connect each of their copies with a copy of the other vertex in a neighboring copy. So this edge leads to appearance of this edge and of this edge as well. So we make this in several layers, and after that we add one vertex, which is connected to all the vertices of the last copy. So this construction was initially introduced by Michielski with exactly two layers. And here we have an example with four layers. And he proved that the chromatic number of such a graph increases by one when we take the construction with two layers. If we replace these two by a large number, then in general this proposition doesn't hold. But 30 years later, Stieglitz proved that if we take an odd cycle and start iterating this construction with the old cycle, then the chromatic number increases by one with each step. And moreover, we may see that again, this graph has no small odd cycles. Namely, if we take an odd cycle with 2 hard life plus 3 vertices and take these parameters, then we won't have odd cycles of length 2r plus 1 or less. So the common property of all these examples is that the number of vertices in them grows almost as r to the power of n minus 1, where r is chosen such that we have no odd cycles of length at most to r plus 1, or equivalently that all r balls are bipartite, and n is the constant which bounds the chromatic number. So the chromatic number of G is strictly larger than n. And Erdős conjectured in the 70s that in fact this order is best possible in R. So he conjectured that if we have a graph on D vertices and its chromatic number is greater than n, then it should contain an odd cycle of this length, roughly the root of order n minus 1 from D. This conjecture was proved by Kirstedt, Smerelli, and Proton, and moreover, they proved more general statement, which again tells us about the graphs where each ball has small chromatic number, not exactly 2, but any small number. And here is the formulation of their theorem. If we have a graph on V vertices, and if each ball of this radius has a chromatic number of at most C, then the global chromatic number of the graph is bounded by this. And if we substitute C equaling 2, then we obtain exactly Erdős conjecture. Okay, but returning to the question which I told in the beginning, from this form of this theorem, it is not quite visible what is the direct bound of the number of vertices in a graph which satisfies our properties. So I would like to reformulate this theorem with using different notation. Perhaps I would like to put it on the board as well. So assume that we have three positive integers n, r, and c. C will denote this locally chromatic number, r will denote the radius of balls, and n will denote the global chromatic number. So C, R and C I have already introduced, or the radius of balls. And C is the chromatic number, or the bound for chromatic number of the balls. And so we introduce this function on three parameters, f sub c of n and r, which is the maximal number f, such that for each graph g on f vertices, if the chromatic number of each ball of radius r is at most c, then the chromatic number of the whole graph is at most n. And we would like to reformulate the results mentioned before in these terms. So the Erdős theorem, it says something about f2 of nr, but surely we can apply the monotonicity. And we see this bound from the Erdős result, this bound from the construction without odd cycles, and we have this bound from the last theorem I mentioned. And now I would like to discuss a bit how tight is this theorem. So we see that this lower bound is, roughly speaking, a polynomial in R of degree k. For the case of c equaling 2, for the case of odd cycles, we see that f2 of n r is at least r over 2 n 2 by n minus 1, the k to the power of n minus 1. And as the examples show, this is sharp. But what happens if we look at greater values of c? So first of all, we see that if c is greater than 2, then this is the bound only for several values of n, several values of the global chromatic number. And surely we can say something about the other values using the same monotonicity, but it is not clear why these bounds will be tight. Maybe there might appear some non-integer exponent here. So at the time when Kirstedt, Semeradi, and Trotter proved this theorem, they knew one more supporting example of this kind. So, I'm sorry, there is a typo, so I would like to write it on the board. So fc of 2c minus 2r is less than 2r plus 3 by c squared. So this has a linear order in R, although if we look at 2c minus 1, by the theorem, we will have R over 4 to R over 4 squared. So when we jump from 2c minus 2 to 2c minus 1, we have a jump from linear order to the quadratic. And so the nature of the question is whether these jumps will arise for the large values of n. And in fact, now I may answer to this question. The answer is in affirmative. So these jumps appear for every value of k. If we take, if we put this number instead of n, k by c minus 1 plus 1, then the order is k. But if we subtract 1, then we have the order in R k equaling to k minus 1. And it remains constant on a segment of n c minus 1. Yes. So here we have k, but we divide by R. So this is the first result which I would like to show. And also I may tell that this, now we see that this estimate is almost tight in some sense. Okay, surely when it works. So when R is large with respect to k when we fix the global chromatic number and increase radius, the radius of the walls. So if n will grow large, much larger than r, then surely this bound, it will provide some estimate due to monotonicity, but only this one. So it would be better, it would be interesting to obtain some other estimates in this situation. So here is one particular case which is well investigated. This is the case when r equals 1. So when we look at the usual neighborhoods of the vertices. So if we look at this quantity, so we ask if all the walls of radius 1 are bipartite, what can we say about the global chromatic number of graphs? This question is closely connected to the Ramsey number r of k3. And since the order of these Ramsey numbers is known, it immediately leads to the estimate of our quantity of this quantity. But unfortunately, if we increase the radius, this connection is not so clear, so the estimates are not so clear as well. In 2011, Bialov and me proved this estimate for the case when c equals 2, for the case when there are no small cycles, and we see the interesting relation. So here we have r to the power of n minus 1, and here we have, roughly speaking, n to the power of r plus 1. So it seems that these two situations, when r grows and n remains constant, and vice versa, they are quite different from each other. And now I may generalize this estimate for the case of arbitrary chromatic number of the walls. And this estimate has also an order of r plus 1 in n. And we may remember that Erdős estimate is of this form. So we have n to r, roughly n to r from below, and n to 4r from above. And to my best knowledge, which may happen to be poor, maybe this is the best estimate which is known up to now. So in this case, we see that this number grows polynomially in n, but we don't know the correct S1. So how much time do I have? Okay, so I'll try to sketch the proofs. The proof of the lower bound is, in fact, combinatorial and quite simple. So we make every natural thing. So we take our graph G, and we try to find several sets such that each set of vertices lies in some ball of radius r, and such that these sets are disconnected from each other. Then we may throw them, and the chromatic number will decrease by at most c. And in fact, we may do it in the following way, as we see here. So this remaining set is n, and we may have this estimate for the remaining set. And the idea is, of the proof of this lemma is also very simple. We just take one vertex, we look at the balls centered in it of radius 0, 1, and so on, r plus 1. And on one of these r plus 1 steps, the volume, so the set, the number of vertices in this ball will increase by at most this factor. So we take these two neighboring balls. We will throw out this, and we put this layer to M in order to prevent the two sets to be connected. And we proceed again with the remaining one. So this is the main idea of the proof of the lower bound. The upper bound, on the other hand, the construction has more topological background. I would like to remind the definition of neighborhood complex of a graph. If you have a graph, then the neighborhood complex is the simplicial complex with a set of vertices V. And we put the vertices into a simplex if they all have a common neighbor. So this notion was introduced by Lovaas when he made, as far as I know, the first his proof of Knezar conjecture. And the main lemma in this first proof was that if this simplicial complex is K-connected, then the chromatic number of the graph is at least K plus 3. The same lemma was used by Stieglitz when he proved the lower bound for the chromatic number of the generalized Michelski construction. In fact, he proved that the neighborhood of this construction is a suspension of the neighborhood complex of the initial graph. And to prove our upper bound, we make different construction. Namely, for any two graphs, G and H, we make a construction, a new graph, which is denoted by this, such that its neighborhood complex is a join of, is homotopy equivalent to a join of the neighborhood complexes of the initial graphs. And it looks as follows. We take several layers. Initially, we put onto each layer the direct product of G and H. Not only the vertex set, but also with all the edges of this direct product. Then we connect each two neighboring layers exactly in the same way as in Michelski construction. And final step, we contract all the vertices corresponding to the same vertex G here into one vertex. So we contract all such vertices into one vertex. And on the other end, we contract all the vertices corresponding to the other one into one vertex. And thus we get our construction. So it may be easily seen that the local properties of this graph, if we put two R layers in the middle, then R local properties of this graph are inherited from G and H. So if we do G and H with good R local properties, then they also hold for this graph. On the other hand, if we have this condition that the neighborhood complex is the join of two neighborhood complexes, then the global chromatic number will grow. And using this construction with adding complete graph on C vertices on each step, we obtain this estimate.
Thank you very much.
So you mentioned portions graphs such as the Knezar graphs and
platforms. Well, I think you can think about Lazarus graphs as sort of a discretization of the course of the graph.
Yes, and that was initially, that was more or less what Lovas thought about when he proved this conjecture.
That's one of the questions.
Well, here we have this guy. We have this gap, and it seems to me that this is the correct order of our function. So it seems to me that that it should be of order, it should be order n to r plus something bound. But right now I don't know any support.
Wait, what's the situation? For r equals 1, so that's a simple case.
For r equals 1?
What's the gap between lower and upper bound?
So the constant. The ratio is a constant.
The ratio is constant for chromatic number 2. For r equals 1, if you want to go from c to r.
I don't know, I think it will
some.
Any other questions? Not there.